It was 1945 and the war with the world had come to an end. America was finally at peace and was left with a booming economy and prospering workforce. It was the ideal time in the American economy for bright new inventions and ideas. One innovator whose future looked especially promising was Preston Tucker, an ambitious salesman, visionary, and inventor who had gained some notoriety from his previous design success of the Tucker turret, a gun used during World War II on the B-29 bomber. With life on the home front returning to normal, Tucker realized the need for an affordable automobile for a growing American family. He quickly seized the opportunity to produce a completely original all-American automobile, the Tucker Torpedo. Tucker felt a responsibility to provide the public with a safer and more affordable automobile, but was deterred in reaching his goals when government agents and members of the Securities and Exchange Commission became determined to ruin Tucker's reputation, cripple his corporation, and strip him of his individual rights.
Tucker began his quest to produce his automobile when the Tucker Corporation was formed in 1946. The group of men who established the company included Preston Tucker himself, two former Ford Motor Company designers, and an assortment of other experienced auto industry workers. The corporation was finally able to purchase a plant in which to produce Preston Tucker's unique automobile. The plant, located in Cicero, Illinois, spanned 475 acres, making it the largest manufacturing plant in the world. Before the Tucker could even be mass-produced, 100,000 customers put their names on a waiting list to buy this new automobile. Among the features of Tucker's new car were its all-wheel disc brakes, center-mounted steering-controlled headlight, and seat belts, all as standard. Never before in history had there been another new car company with so many customers waiting for the first model. With the accolades and excitement of several automotive publications, things were looking very bright for the Tucker Corporation. Money was coming in at a steady rate, and America was growing more eager to purchase this innovative automobile. Mechanics Illustrated published an article on the Tucker, expressing their great excitement by stating, "Tucker is building an automobile. And brother, it's a real automobile. I want to go on the record here and now as saying that this is the most amazing American car I've ever seen today. This car is real dynamite, and if proven reliable, will make every other car made in America look like Harrigan's hack with the wheels on it." Additionally, True Magazine tested the car and wrote an article stating, "It is the safest car ever built, period." The big three automotive companies at the time, Ford, Chrysler, and GM, felt threatened. Tucker and the corporation began selling stocks to interested customers. Soon, government agencies began to poke and pry into the Tucker Corporation. They were sporadic in their harassment of the Tucker Corporation throughout 46 and 47, but didn't become a significant barrier for Tucker until 1948, when an investigation of the Tucker plant was ordered by the SEC. The investigation dragged on for over a year, and the Tucker plant was constantly filled with SEC and FBI agents. The SEC agreed to keep the investigation private only if Tucker would turn over all the plant's books and records. Unfortunately, before Tucker had a chance to respond, confidential information was leaked to Drew Pearson, a well-known news columnist and radio commentator.
There was a guy named Drew Pearson who had a radio show who was just started slamming him, and that's sort of what started the government going too.
He made a catastrophic prediction of the Tucker Corporation, claiming that the SEC and Justice Department investigation would blow the Tucker firm higher than a kite. Within a week of Pearson's dire prediction, Tucker's stock lost more than 50% of its value. Pearson wasn't the only media source to slander Tucker, as there was an onslaught of scrutiny from other editorials concerning his new vehicle. Determined to keep his business running, Tucker refused to give up the records, stating that the plant would be impossible to run without them. In response to his persistent refusal, the SEC filed a court order that forced Tucker to hand over the records, and in order to save money for the corporation, Tucker mournfully closed down the plant.
The growing tension between the Tucker Corporation and the government was not simply two competitors butting heads, but was the result of several unrelenting businessmen with a grudge against Preston Tucker. Leading the charge against Tucker was Homer Ferguson, otherwise known as the Senator from Detroit, who had a reputation of being protective of Motor City's automakers. Also, Harry McDonald, an SEC agent, and Thomas B. Hahn, regional SEC chief, both had a reputation of animosity towards Tucker. The SEC continued to file suits, and the media continued to berate Tucker and his corporation. Finally, the tragic day came for Preston Tucker, when on March 3, 1949, he lost all control of his prized corporation. This loss was not the final blow for Tucker. On June 10, 1949, it was announced that Preston Tucker and his seven associates received an indictment of 31 counts of fraud. While the government was hard at work in an attempt to end Tucker's success, he fortunately had the full support of the country. Letters rushed in daily, with Americans expressing approval of and excitement for his car, encouraging Tucker not to give up so easily. In response to their pleas, on June 15, 1948, Preston Tucker wrote an open letter to the automobile industry. We have promised American motorists a completely new rear-engine motor car, and hundreds of thousands have written us that they are ready and waiting to buy it. Every day, letters come to us from people who know that in fighting to put the rear-engine Tucker on the road, we are at the same time fighting for their right as motorists to get the finest engineering American ingenuity can produce. We are going to justify the support these motorists so generously have given us. We are going to give them the car they want at a price they can afford and without paying tribute to the black market.
On October 5, 1949, the Tucker trial began, but ended quickly due to complications. A retrial was scheduled to start the following week, and with a new jury, the trial began. With the new trial underway, Preston Tucker faced 155 years of prison and fines if found guilty. First, the SEC accused Tucker of being a criminal, describing him as a con man who collected investors' money, never intending to actually build the car. Secondly, the SEC claimed that Tucker had never made a single of his revolutionary automobiles, despite the fact that SEC and FBI agents watched 37 of the cars being produced during their investigation. In response to this false claim, Tucker had all 51 of his prized automobiles lined up around the courtroom, allowing the court to observe the so-called non-existent cars. For 3 months, the SEC overwhelmed the court, bringing witness after witness to the stand, some of whom even ended up inadvertently supporting Tucker with their testimonies. For example, James Good, an employee of the SEC who knowingly stole records from the Tucker Corporation, was questioned about his actions and stated, "There doesn't have to be a charge. One can always be drummed up." Disheartened and disinterested after months of detrimental testimony, many of Tucker's co-workers and most of the country turned their backs on him when he needed them most. After all 73 SEC witnesses had spoken, the defense stunned the court with an unexpected response. Attorney Daniel Glasser stood and said, "It is impossible to present a defense when there has been no offense." With their short proclamation, the case came to a close. Judge Labaye declared, "You are dealing here with offenses that require specific intent. Unless there is proof that the particular defendant whose case is being considered was acting in bad faith and with an intent to do wrong, he must be found not guilty." With Tucker's proclaimed innocence on all charges, the court erupted with celebration. The excitement, however, was short-lived. Although the legal battle had been won, the damage that had been done was irreversible. Tucker lost his plant, his corporation was completely bankrupt, and his credibility with the public was destroyed.
It destroyed him. Completely. He was a broken man for 3 or 4 years. He was scrambling, trying to clear his name. He came back to Ypsilanti, you know, with his tail between his legs, and so his respect, and even in the little town of Ypsilanti, was, you know, he had to build that back up again.
Preston Tucker was completely stripped of his individual rights as a private automaker, not because he had gone against the law, but simply because he created a method of transportation that threatened the monopoly of the automobile industry at that time. The Tucker Torpedo was amazingly built, and so well fabricated that over 50 years later, 47 out of the 51 cars produced still remain in excellent working condition. Not only was the Torpedo mechanically brilliant, but the safety innovations were tremendous. Within a decade of the court case that ultimately put an end to the Tucker Torpedo, the government slowly began to require all large automotive companies to install many of the Tucker safety devices in their cars. In 2002, a study was done by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration. In that year, 24,000 lives in the U.S. were saved in motor accidents from safety innovations alone, many of which were created by Tucker. By destroying the Tucker Automobile Corporation, the federal government caused the deaths of hundreds of thousands of Americans who otherwise could have been saved by the safety features Preston Tucker built into his cars. This is not to mention the millions of motor accident-induced injuries suffered by Americans, many of which would have been avoidable by the safety features introduced in the Torpedo.
We see that the Tucker was not only a great car, but also a life-saving device, dramatically and illegally shut down by the government. The hasty ending of the Tucker Corporation and its car was a regrettable decision, one that cost innocent American lives. Despite his responsibly taking a stand to create safer and more affordable automobiles for the American people, Preston Tucker was deprived of his personal rights by biased media presentations and monopolizing government agencies.